रिकॉर्डिंग स्टार्ट कर दी मैंने। गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। इन टुडेज लेक्चर वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट क्लस्टर कॉम्प्लेक्सेस स्पेशली ऑफ द ट्रांजिशन मेटल्स। तो इन द प्रीवियस लेक्चर्स वी हैव डिस्कस्ड डिफरेंट टाइप ऑफ ट्रांजिशन मेटल कॉम्प्लेक्सेस and containing different type of ligands, like we have seen monoheptoligand, diheptoligand, triheptoligand and tetraheptoligand, and then we continued that discussion up to hexaheptoligand, that is the transition metal arene complexes. Before that we discussed different type of carbonyl compounds, metal carbonyls, alkyls and aryl compounds which are containing a bit of ionic character. So at the end of your unit, now the last type of complexes that we will discuss, they are the clusters. So clusters, you can imagine what is a cluster when a metal complex, so many molecules, they are getting aggregated. So a cluster is more like an aggregate of metal and the ligands together. And sometimes these clusters, they can reach up to the level of your nano size. So they have really very important applications as nanomaterials also. So let us start this topic, clusters. So the first type of clusters that were first seen, they were the metal carbonyl clusters. And they were characterized by the X-ray diffraction studies. The nuclearities were up to the range of 30 to 40. And the different scientists have performed actually this work, but this discovery by X-ray crystallography, X-ray diffraction, it was done by Shini. And it was seen that such type of clusters, they are neutral, sometimes they are neutral, or otherwise they can be mono, di, or tri anionic in nature. And when you protonate these type of anions, they become mono, di, or trihydrides. So sometimes these type of compounds, they can be studied by the Fischer-Tropsch reaction. And then some carbonyls, they are replaced by the hydrocarbon ligand. So we have seen this thing, that this is very common reaction whenever you react a metal carbonyl with some hydrocarbon ligand, especially the unsaturated one, the carbonyl get replaced because due to the similarity between them. So Fischer-Tropsch reaction was used to prepare the derivative of such metal carbonyl clusters, and then Wade was a scientist who proposed a rule that just like the metalloboranes, these clusters have some similarities between them. So this is a typical cluster. You can see this is metal cyclopentadienyl cluster. Metal is the nickel here, and these nickels, they are attached together with the metal-metal bond, and as well they are attached to different cyclopentadienyls. So it's the nickel cyclopentadienyl, they together forming a cluster. So this is a cluster without a carbonyl attached. Is an example. So in the similar manner, so many metal atoms, they can be involved of different transition metals and different type of ligand. When they form an aggregate together, which is thermodynamically stable, you call it a cluster. Similarly, you can see the metal sulfur clusters, and that are the electron carriers in the biological system. These clusters are really very common, and in the biological system, we have seen carrier proteins containing the center transition metal complex, which is known as metallur enzyme. So in those type of enzymes, you can see such type of metal sulfur clusters. So they perform the function of carrying the electrons in the biological system, and essentially the metal involved is iron, molybdenum or vanadium. So the biomimetic clusters, which are actually similar to the clusters found in the biological system, they are known as biomimetic clusters. They were introduced by a scientist Hall. This is another one example. Then the early transition metal oxide cluster. Transition metal oxides, they are also known to form larger size aggregates. And but the important point is they do not contain any metal-metal bond. Like so many clusters right now, we have seen that they contain bonding between the metal and metal. But what happens when the early transition metal oxides, they form cluster, they react such type of bonding. Rather, between the different metal atoms, they have oxygen atom involved, and these oxygen atoms, they occupy the non-bridging terminal position. So these type of clusters, they are heteropoly acids basically, and they are salts which are known as heteropolymetallates. So these clusters are also known for their chemical activity, and such type of clusters like the metal oxide cluster, they are developed by so many scientists in France and United States. And if you see the common structure that we can get is XM4 12 O40 X minus 8. This is the common formula for the clusters, the metal oxide clusters known in case of your oxidation catalysis, and this is called as Kegin structure. So here your central metal atom, X is your central metal atom, and this could be the silica 4 or germanium 4, right? Otherwise it could be phosphorus 5 and arsenic 5. So this type of metal atom, it is located at the center of an XO4 tetrahedron surrounded by the 12 octahedron, that is MO6. So here metal could be the molybdenum and tungsten, having the common vertices and summits. So the very robust structure includes 12M double bond, that is metal oxygen bond terminal ligand, in addition to the terminal oxoligand. So you can have a terminal oxoligand as well as the metal double bond oxygen as a terminal ligand involved in such clusters. So another category is when the octahedral early transition metal halide, they form cluster. So they are having the octahedral structure, and when that structure is repeated, you get a cluster. So MO6Cl8+ is a cluster belonging to the category. And also you have M6X12N+, where your metal atom could be a niobium, tantalum, rhenium, and X is, of course, it is a halogen, because we are looking at the transition metal halide cluster. So the N could be here 2, 3, 4. And in such type of clusters, they contain both strongly anchored inner halide ligand, that the bridge metal, and the substitution labile outer chloride ligand, that are terminal in the 6 axial and equatorial position, and also give rise to a 6 hexa substitution chemistry. So the chemistry means they are reactive at that place, they show a particular reaction at which are substitutive in nature. So hexa substitution reaction, in all the 6 equatorial or axial positions, they are replaced by some other group. So such type of reactions are shown by these clusters. So, example of this M6X12 cluster is given here. This is niobium 6 and 12 chloro, having a charge of 2+. So, your white colored circles, they are the M metal atom. And if you can see, these metals, they are forming an octahedral structure. These white circles, they are forming an octahedral. This is octahedral. And after the formation of the octahedron by the metal itself, now each of the metal is containing ligands. So one metal is containing two ligands, and they are forming what? They are forming bridges with the two metal atoms. So this is the typical structure of such cluster complexes. Now it is also possible to design mixed inorganic and organometallic systems. You can mix them by appropriate decoration of such clusters. So like you can in the case of MO6Br44 negative, the 6 apical bromine ligand, they can be substituted by triflase, and then by the functional pyridines to synthesize diketanic cluster code ferrocenyl dendrimers. This is a dendrimer. This is a dendrimer. You can see at the center what complex is involved. At the center you have MO6Br12 2- complex, and then the 6 of the bromine, they were replaced by the triflase, and then by the functional pyridines. So what we get a diatomic cluster core. At the core, it is having a cluster, and this is what? This is a dendrimer. So the structure is like a dendrite, similar to the dendrons found in our nervous system. That is why it is called dendrimer. Such type of complexes can also be prepared containing a cluster compound at the center. Then we can have high nuclearity cluster, and they reach up to the size of nanoparticles. So you can actually prepare nanoparticles from such cluster. The X-ray diffraction has allowed to characterize clusters up to 30 to 40 metal atoms. So if you have 30 to 40 metal atoms in your clusters, then you can characterize it with the help of X-ray diffraction. For example, here we have a cluster of the platinum and carbonyl hydride. So you have PT38, carbonyl 44 and H2 2-. This is the cluster. And also we have this gold cluster here, that is AU29, PPH314, Cl6, Cl2. So such type of clusters, when you have metal atoms only up to 30 to 40 atoms, then you can use the X-ray diffraction study. But if we get a larger size cluster, like in the case of these two clusters, when you have 55 gold atoms in a single cluster and you have 146 copper atoms in the single cluster, so you cannot characterize them by using X-ray. It becomes really difficult. But still, we have an electronic microscope to study such clusters. So this is the structure of this copper cluster, which is having the formula copper 146, then your selenium 73, PPH3 thrice 30. This is a mixed type of cluster, and you call them high nuclearity cluster. High nuclearity because you have so many metal atoms as compared to the ligand. You have only 30 triphenyl phosphines involved here, but you have 146 copper atoms and 73 seleniums here. This is high nuclearity cluster, and they are so large that they reach to the size of the nanoparticle. Then it is also possible that the metal atoms, they are pegged like spheres from the central metal, and each atom is surrounded by 12 atoms. That is forming the first layer. Then you have your second layer that contains 42 atoms, and in this way, giant cluster can be prepared, where your nth layer contains 10 into n square plus 2 number of atoms. So with each of the layer, you are increasing the number of atoms involved, and with each of the layer, your cluster size is increasing. So in the nth layer, you will have 10 n square plus 2 atoms. And the example is like a 5-layer cluster. It will contain 561 atoms. So n is what? N is the number of the layer. Okay, so in the fifth layer, you will get 10 into 5 into 5, that is 25. So you will get a 5-layer of cluster, it will contain 561 atoms. So in this manner, the Mosier, he characterized this cluster of palladium. Palladium 561, phenyl 60 and OAC, that is acyl, in 180 number. So here the diameter of the cluster was about 25 angstrom, and SMID also synthesized the palladium cluster up to the 8th layer, and the structural formula was this. So X-ray absorption spectroscopy has shown that the palladium-palladium distances, they are very close to those of the palladium metal, and these giant clusters are what? They are so large that they have reach up to the size of nanoparticles. So these are what is giant clusters, and they are just like the nanoparticles. So this is actually the picture of your M2057 up to the 8 layers. Which cluster? It is palladium 2057, Fe84 and O1600. So large size clusters. Now ligands are also playing a role in the cluster formation. And these ligands, they can bridge at least 3 or 4 metals. That is why the cluster formation becomes easy. It becomes feasible. So we can have here X3 type of ligands, which are capping the 3 metals. These are the trivalent ligands, such as you can have a nitrido N, You can have phosphido-P or carbines or alkylidine CR, and they are able to hold three metal atoms. So they become very important when the cluster formation takes place. They can cap three metals as the X ligand for each of the three metals. So your alkylidine tricobalt nonacarbonyl complexes, they are the most classical example of such type of complex. Then the NO ligand, that can be a LX ligand in the monometallic complex. It can become such X3 ligand when it caps three metal in the cluster. How it will do that? It will use the pi electrons and the lone pair of electron involved in the NO ligand. Otherwise, it will be what? It is simple LX type of ligand. But it becomes sometimes as a X3 ligand in the cluster complexes where it is able to cap three metals. So the 15 electron organometallic fragments having at least three non-bonding electrons, such as your MCO3, here at least three non-bonding electrons are also involved, like the metal could be your cobalt, rhodium, iridium, or it could be MCO4 where the metal could be manganese, technetium, rhenium. They can also be X3 ligand in capping three 17 electron metal fragments. And thereby they complete their number of valence electron to 18 in this manner. So the similar reasoning you can apply to the capping of a chloro ligand, which can be it can be L2X ligand where it caps three metal in the cluster. These are the examples of such type of complexes. Your carbonyl is actually present on each of the cobalt atom, and these cobalts are forming a bond together, and here your alkylidine, that is CR, this carbon, this is able to form triple bond with three metal atoms. So if you can see here, this carbon is actually capping three cobalt atoms, so this is able to form a cluster compound because three metal atoms, they could be hold together at the same time. So similarly, you can have other type of ligands also which can hold the three or more metals at the same time. And you can have X4 type of ligand which can cap four metals at a time. So here the carbide ligand, that is the C. In the carbide ligand, your C can cap four metals, and so it becomes X4. So the other examples are organometallic 14 electron fragments such as MCO3, where your metal could be iron, ruthenium, osmium, or MCO2, where your metal could be chromium, molybdenum, and tungsten. Then we can have carbonyl and phosphinidine ligands, which can cap 3 to 4 metals. So here, the carbonyl ligand, the CO contributes 2 by N electron to the number of valence electron of the metal atom. So N being here the number of the metal atom in the cluster that are capped by the carbonyl. So if your carbonyl has capped three metal atoms, like you can see here, the carbonyl is capping three metals, 1, 2, 3. So if it has capped three metal atoms, it is contributing 2 electrons in total. Okay, one carbonyl contributes 2 electrons. So what will be the contribution to each of the metal atom? It will be 2/3. Similarly, if it is capping four metal atoms, then what will be the electronic contribution to each of the metal atom? It will be 2/4. So this electronic contribution goes to individual metal atom. So here N being the number of metal atom in the clusters that are capped by carbonyl. So this is an example of Fe4, CP4, CO4. So with each of the iron, you have one CP, that is cyclopentadienyl, and you have four carbonyls, and all the carbonyls, they are capping three metal atoms here. That is why it is getting a structure like a cluster-like structure. So here each CO caps three metals, and each metal is bonded to three carbonyls. So that brings actually 3 × 2/3 is equal to 2 electrons. So I hope you get it right. Each carbonyl is capping three metals. So each carbonyl is contributing 2/3 electrons as per the formula 2/N. One carbonyl is contributing 2 electrons, and if it is capped 2 or 3 metals, so contribution is 2/3. And since each of the metal is combined with 3 carbonyl, so for 3 carbonyl, it will be 3 × 2/3, that is 2 electrons each. So this is the nature of bonding in such type of clusters. Now here each iron is also bonded to 3 neighboring iron atoms. So को लाइक यू कैन सी द आयरन एटम, दिस आयरन एटम इट इज बॉन्डेड टू दिस आयरन एंड दिस आयरन. सो अपार्ट फ्रॉम द फैक्ट दैट इट इज अटैच्ड टू थ्री कार्बोनिल एंड वन सीपी, इट इज ऑल्सो अटैच्ड टू थ्री आयरन एज वेल. सो दैट काउंट इज द 3x ligand एंड दे विल ब्रिंग 3 इलेक्ट्रॉन टू दिस मेटल. So each Fe may be written as your FeL2X is, that is 18 electron in total. So let us count the electrons. So the iron is getting 5 electrons from the Cp and 2 electrons from the carbonyl. So it will be 7 and then 3 electrons it is getting from the 3 neighboring atoms. So total of 10 electrons and 8 are already present in the iron. So in this manner it completes its 18 electrons. Now, many clusters, they are known to exist in several oxidation states, and that is because of the degeneracy of their HOMO and LUMO. So what does it mean? Degeneracy is when the orbitals are having similar energy. So sometimes what happens in the clusters, the HOMO and LUMO of the metal atoms, because the metal can exist several oxidation states, and this is especially the case of your transition metals. So when the same several orbitals, they are having the same energy due to symmetry, and what happens then, the electron, they could be anywhere, and your HOMO and LUMO, they become equal in energy. So here the steric protection by the ligands of the metal wave redox center, what is seen in such cases, several oxidation states are formed. So in particular, this is the case for metal cyclopentadienyl clusters. That is, you can see metallocene clusters. For example, in the just the cluster that we have just seen, FeCpCO4N. So here your N could be minus 1, 0, plus 1 or plus 2. Anything could be the charge on the individual unit, and that charge depends upon the oxidation state of the iron. Right? We have just seen this. The oxidation state of iron, that will decide the whatever charge will be present on the cluster unit. So this could be the N, could be the charge, could be minus 1, 2, plus 2. So when you study such complexes in cyclic voltammetry, we are studying the different oxidation states. So because the single cluster, it can able to show different oxidation states. So when you perform the cyclic voltammetry, you will get a cascade of several chemically reversible waves that is showing multiple oxidation and reductions occurring in the cluster. So here the no decomposition of the oxidized and reduced species takes place. They are not getting decomposed, rather they are quickly changing their oxidation state, and that is showing the degeneracy of their HOMO and LUMO. They are receiving electron, they are losing electron, but there is no complete electrolysis, and all these reactions are completely reversible in nature. So, electrochemically reversible, fast electron transfer, and it means that there is no significant structure change in the course of electron transfer. So, when you study such complexes in the cyclic voltammetry, you get the potential of the anodic and cathodic wave differ by 58 by n millivolt, and it shows, we know that when such difference is obtained in the cyclic voltammetry, it shows that your process is completely reversible in nature, and it never change when the sweep rate varies. When you change the sweep rate, that is your potential scan rate, when you change it, this ratio is same. So this indicates that the reaction is, the process is completely reversible in nature. Now this is the diagram, the actual diagram in which the cyclic voltammogram of this cluster compound has been shown. So in place of a duck shaped structure, here you can see multiple cascade is obtained for different type of oxidation and reduction. So in this part of the diagram, you can see this is the reduction scan, reducing scan, and here multiple reductions are obtained for Fe4 2 plus to Fe4 plus, and Fe4 plus to Fe4 0, and Fe4 0 to Fe4 negative. These are the multiple reductions possible during the cathodic scan. And during the anodic scan, multiple oxidations are possible. So your species is never getting decomposed, right? It is rather changing the oxidation state so quickly and so easily. So multiple oxidations can be seen here in the oxidation scan. So this is a very special property of the metal cluster, especially those which are containing the cyclopentadienyl, that is the CP as a ligand. Then we can have the localized electron count in the cluster and their limits. So you can actually count the electrons, but it has certain limits. So number of valence electrons for small cluster. For small cluster, it means it will have lesser number of metal atoms, lesser number of ligand. Then the 18 electron rule remains valid. They will surely follow the 18 electron rule. So it is possible to count the electrons as we have already done it above. For your FeCpCO4 ligand, we have counted the electronic contribution. So the most common carbonyl ligand in the cluster is the L ligand when it is terminal. So when the carbonyl is terminal, it is L type of ligand. X ligand for each metal when it bridges the two metal. When it is bridging the two metal, it becomes X type of ligand. And 2x/3 when it caps three metal, then x/2 when it caps four metals. So in this manner, each metal is an X ligand for the neighboring metal also. Like we have seen in this case, each iron atom was attached to three other iron atoms as well. So in the similar case, in the ruthenium carbonyl, Ru3CO12, all the carbonyls are terminal. And each ruthenium is represented as RuL4X2 since it bears four carbonyls and two ruthenium. So these two ruthenium, they are behaving like an X ligand. Right, they are contributing one electron each, and the L ligand, they are contributing two electrons each. So in this manner, you can find it out what is the role of the ligand in the cluster complex. But on the other hand, in Fe3CO4, so the Fe3 and CO4, so here you can see one of the Fe bear four terminal CO, where is the two other Fe's bear only three terminal CO. So this Fe is having 4 CO as a terminal ligand, and the two Fe's, they are having only 3, and the two carbonyl as a bridging ligand. So here what you can do, the first Fe is represented. This Fe is FeL4. Your carbonyl is L type of ligand contributing 2 electrons. So this is FeL4, and the two ferrous, two iron, they are representing the X ligand. So FeL4X2. And the other two Fe's, how you will represent them? This will be FeL3, L is your carbonyl again, and X4. X4 is, it has 4 X type of ligand. So what are the 4 X type of ligand? First, it is attached to the two iron atoms, right? So these are the 2 X, and then the two carbonyls which are bridging in nature. So they are also behaving like a X ligand. Whenever carbonyl is present in the bridging format, it is behaving like X type of ligand. So these three Fe's, all the three iron atoms, they are following the 18 electron rule here. Now, number of cluster electrons, this is also possible to calculate. We can calculate the total number of electrons present in the cluster complex. So the number of the cluster electron, that is NCE, is also defined for each cluster. It is the total number obtained by adding the valence electron of all the metals of the cluster to the number of electrons brought by the ligand. So when you add the total number of electron contributed by metal and the number of electron contributed by the ligand, when you add them up, you get the NCE, that is number of cluster electrons. So the electrons in the metal-metal bond, they are not added here. Like NEC is the formula, common formula you can take is XNT 2NL NX plus Q. What does it mean? Here XNT, this is number of electrons contributed by metal, then you have 2NL. How many electrons are, N is the number of your L type of ligand, and your L type of ligand, they are contributing 2 electrons. Okay, so it is 2NL. Then N is the number of X type of ligand, singly bonded. So they are contributing only one electron. And Q is the charge, the overall charge on the cluster complex. So the example taken here is M3CO12, where your M, the metal, could be iron or ruthenium. So here the NEC, the cluster electrons, total number of cluster electrons is 3 into 8 plus 12 into 2. Because there is no X electron involved and no charge is present. and you have three metal atoms each containing the 8 electrons. So three metal atom with 8 electrons each, it will be 24, and you have 12 L type of ligand, that is 12 into 2. So a total of 48 electrons are present in this type of cluster. And you are not counting, remember this, you are not counting the metal-metal bond electrons here. Now this NEC, the number of cluster electrons in cluster, it does not detail the bonding mode of carbonyl ligand. For example, if they are terminal bridging or capping, this does not you cannot identify this. Like in case of this carbonyl Me3CO12, when you have calculated that it is containing 48 electrons in the cluster, you cannot deduce any other information from this. You cannot find out what is the structure of these COs in the actual position in the cluster. Like if they are present as a terminal ligand, as a bridging ligand, or as a capping ligand. So since the 18 electron rule is fulfilled, the NEC is equal to X times 18 if X is the number of metal minus 2 Y electrons of the Y metal-metal bonds. So now what you have to do, you have to find out, because we know that they are following the 18 electron rule. So your NEC would be equal to 18X. That is, X is the number of the metal minus 2Y. Y is the number of metal-metal bonds. Since we are not calculating this NEC from, we are not taking into consideration the metal-metal bond. So we will minus it from here. So in this example, you get it like 18 into 3, because you have three metal atoms involved, and 2 minus 2 into 3. So 3 is the number of metal-metal bonds. When you perform this calculation, you get 48. It means that both these values are similar now. Here also we are getting 48. Here also we are getting 48. So it means that the electronic contributions are similar, like we have taken in this case. This electron count, it actually works for small cluster, but generally it breaks down for hexanuclear cluster because of the electronic delocalization. When your cluster size is becoming large and large, then what will happen? Then there will be mixing of the HOMOs and LUMOs. There will be more degeneracy involved. And in that case, since your orbitals are not localized, your electrons will also be not localized. And you will see a huge delocalization. So that starts from the hexanuclear clusters onward. Hexanuclear is when you have 6 metal atoms in your cluster. So the example is your osmium 6 carbonyl 18, and here if you calculate the number of cluster electron, you will get 6 into 8 plus 18 into 2. So this carbonyl is L type of ligand, so 18 into 2, so you get a total of 84 electron. Now this cluster, it is what? It is a mono-capped trigonal bipyramidal structure in which the 18 electron rule is obeyed only for 2 of the 6 osmium atoms. Only 2 osmiums are actually following the 18 electron rule. And this situation is worse for the localized electron count and for the 18 electron rule that do not work at all in the very stable octahedral 86 electron dianine. So what happens now, it gains 2 electron and it converts itself into a dianine, and that is how it follows the 18 electron rule. So, on the other hand, Wade's theory that uses the polyhedral skeleton electron pairs very well rationalizes the electron count in the large organometallic cluster. So, now it is trying to apply the Wade's theory to explain the stability of such cluster compounds and how the electronic contribution is taking place inside them. So, the Wade's theory was taken into account. What is the Wade's rule? Wade's rule was given for the polyboranes, carboranes, metallocarboranes, and transition metal cluster compounds. So Wade was a scientist, and he just observed that the transition metals, they are the electron deficient average size cluster, and he actually correlated their geometries and the electron counts. So what he proposed, the metal must share their available electrons to form the cluster skeleton. So it is not possible that only ligands are involved, but rather a metal has to share its electron pair also, and then only there will be the cluster skeleton formation. So Wade also noticed that the situation is analogous for a polyborane cluster. So in the inorganic chemistry, we have also seen the boranes and polyborines, and the Wade proposed that in the cluster complexes, the bonding, the electronic distribution among the different metal centers, it is much alike than the polyborane clusters. So what happens in the polyborane? So each boron atom, it has three valence electron, right? And it introduces one electron in the bond with hydrogen and leaves two available electron with the three orbitals to contribute to the formation of a cluster. So this is a simple BH fragment, and here three orbitals sp2, three sp2 hybrid orbitals are present on the boron, and it contains only three electrons. So what happens here, this BH fragment, two electrons are free and one electron is getting paired with the hydrogen. So three orbitals are available, but we have only two electrons now. One, two, three orbitals are available. So now a borane is BnHn2-, it has n plus one electron pair to form a cluster. Now if you have n is equal to 6, so you will get an octahedron B6H6-, with one BH at each vertex and 14 electron in the cluster skeleton. So what do you call such a structure as closo? Closo structure, when you have n is equal to 6 and an octahedron like structure of B6H6-, is octane. Because all the vertices of the polyhedron are now occupied. So from the boranes, one can jump to carbonates. You can set up a similarity, and from taking the analogy, you can correlate these two structures. So in the carbonates, you have C. In the place of this B, you have CH units. And then you can correlate the similarities to metalloboranes, which are also containing the transition metals. That will be isostructural if the number of electrons brought by each fragment is identical. So what happens here with C plus, that is three electrons. The C plus will be having three electrons, right? So it will be similar to the boron. And now it is the isoelectronic to boron. So your BH can be replaced by CH plus. So you can establish that analogy by replacing the BH unit with CH plus, because both are now isoelectronic in nature. So now if you look at the closo structure, the B12 polyborane of the closo structure, it is an icosahedron with a B12H12-2- formula. And if you replace the BH2BH by 2CH plus fragment in the position 1 and 2, you will get what? Orthocarborane having the closo structure 1-2B10C2H12 icosahedron. So here you are establishing the analogy between the two type of compounds by taking the isoelectronic fragments together. Similarly, it is also possible to easily demonstrate the 14 electron fragments like FeCO3. The common formula could be your ML3, M could be the FeRU or osmium. So, and COCP can, you can also take them as the BH, because they are also isoelectronic with the BH. So they also bring two electrons to the cluster skeleton, just like the BH fragment. So now, in place of, like in the earlier slide, we see that we are replacing the BH with CH plus. So along with that CH plus, we can also replace it with the other metal fragments, metal nickel fragments, which are having two electrons. So here, in fact, your FeCO3, Fe has 9 valence electrons. 5 in the 3d orbital, 1 in the 4s and 3 in the 4p orbital. Now the 3 of these electrons, they are provided by the 3 carbonyls, and from the 8 metal valence electrons, the filled orbital, 6 electrons are involved in the pi back bonding, which is equivalent in some way to consider that your carbonyl is a X2 type of ligand, and to say that Fe has only now 2 non-bonding electrons. Now what happens when all the electrons are involved in different type of interactions? Now these two non-bonding electrons left on the iron, they will impart the characteristic similar to BH. And now the skeleton of your cluster complex can be prepared just like in case of the BH. Now your FeCO3 fragment with the two non-bonding electrons, it becomes isoelectronic with the BH fragment. So here the three orbitals and two electrons, they remain available in the cluster exactly as the B in the BH. So the 14 electron fragment COCP, it is also isoelectronic with your FeCO3, so it will also behave in the similar manner. And the fragments which are BH, CH plus, MCO3, these are three fragments which are isoelectronic in nature, where your metal could be the iron, ruthenium, osmium, and also the M-CP, where M- could be the cobalt, rhodium, and iridium. These species, they are isoelectronic in nature. They have structural similarities. They have three free orbitals with two electrons, and they are called isolobal. These are the isolobal species. Now, apply the Bates rule to such structures. For example, take a fragment that is MLNXPQ. The Q is the charge, N is the number of L type of ligand, and P is the number of X type of ligand. So the number of number T of the electron given to the cluster is, how will you calculate the number of electron to the cluster? So that T will be equal to NM, that is number of electron from the metal, then 2NL, that is number of ligand of L type, and you multiply it with 2, because each of the L is contributing 2 electron, plus your NH, that is number of X type of electron, minus 12. So yeah, subtracting a number of 12 from here, and your NM is being the number of valence electron of the metal, total number S of the electron brought to the cluster by different fragment is, when you add all the T's and add all 1 minus it. So yeah, the 1 is being the number of electron brought by the ligands that are not counted in the T, because they are counting only the L type of ligand and X type of ligand here. So, if you are not counting any electron in the calculation of T, that you will count it here. For instance, eventually the bridging ligand, like you are not counting them in the T. H is contributing 1 electron to each of the metals, then your carbon is contributing 2 electrons, chlorine 3 electrons, and like this. And your Z is being the algebraic charge. So whatever charge is present on the fragment, and then you calculate, you put it the value here. So your number NH of vertices of the polyhedron is NH is equal to S by 2 minus 1. So all these considerations, they are based on the Bates rule, putting up the similarity between the polyborane and metallocarborane. On the 6BH of your B6H6 2 negative octahedron, 6BH unit, they are arranged like this in the octahedral manner. If you replace them with 6OSCO3 fragment, replace each BH unit with your OSCO3, because they are isolobal in nature. So you get the octahedron, that is OS6CO18 2 negative. With the exact structure, you get it. With the exact negative charge, 2 negative. So the structure could not be explained by the localized NC model, and now you have to take into account the Bates theory. So your 6OSCO6 fragments, they contribute for a total of 12 electrons to the cluster, and it makes a total of 14 electrons with a double negative charge on the cluster. Now, you will calculate the number of vertices as the formula given in the previous slide. So, you will get six vertices in your polyhedron. Similarly, you can replace this BH unit with your COCO3, right, COCO3 unit. And again, you can calculate the total number of electrons, and altogether our total number of 14 electrons are present here. Our number of vertices would be 6. So all these calculations, they can be performed if your number of cluster electrons, that is not applicable, that is not, you cannot explain it by the localized model, that is 18 electron rule. So in that case, you have to take the Bates theory into account. Then different type of structures are possible in case of your boranes, and the similar analogy can be applied to other type of your polycarboranes and these cluster complexes. So it can have a closed structure when your N is 6 to 12, okay. Then it can have a needle structure, and it can also have a arcado structure. So if a BH2 plus fragment is removed from the borane, no electron is removed from the cluster, and therefore the cluster remains unchanged. Only one vertex is now missing. With one vertex missing, you are not removing the electron, rather you are removing one BH2 plus. So now what is becoming? It is becoming the nido structure, and the formula would be BnHn4-. Okay, so BnHn2- is your chloro structure. BnHn4- will be your nido structure. So if you remove another BH2+ here, and you are not removing the electrons, right? So it will be an alkano structure. So here are the three examples. And one vertex is getting reduced each time. So this is the chloro structure. All the BH present on the octahedron corner. Now you are removing one BH from here. So it becomes a pentagonal, more in a sense. This is nido structure. And then you are removing another BH fragment here. So it becomes your alkano structure. So similar analogy can be applied to the metal transition metal cluster complex. So now I have two questions for you from this lecture. First of all, you have to find out the applications of Bates rule for transition metal cluster complexes. How you explain the structure of transition metal clusters by using the Bates theory? And the second question is, you have to prepare a list of at least 10 commercial applications of transition metal cluster complexes. So go to the Google and see the literature present and find out what are the commercial applications where your transition metal clusters are involved. So this was the point of reference for today's lecture, and that is all from my side for today. Thank you so much.